Welcome to another Nature Discovery Screencast. Look over my shoulder and watch as I look for the pure beauty found in nature from the raw videos taken on one of my photo walks. The date of this photo walk was March 22, 2017, and it took place in one of our parks located in Cabarrus County, North Carolina, and that is in the United States. Today we're using Final Cut Pro X on a Mac, and we will be screening these raw videos, creating favorites, and keywording the clips to complete our preliminary workflow. You can also watch our 30 Seconds of Nature screencast, where we take selected raw footage and turn it into 30 seconds or longer videos to be used in the Nature's Wild Things website, where we are building a visual nature field guide to life. Let's hop right in and look at what we have today. March 22nd again, and pretty cool out, bright and sunny, and the photo walk today was productive for the birds and for a few other things that you wouldn't normally think that we're going to take videos of, but we did anyway. Let's start right off with a mourning dove. They're part of the pigeons and doves order and family. And they have a really soft call to them. Here he's... I think we'll play a little here. You can just... barely hear it. The other birds in the background are louder. It's a very soft call. And the camera's moving around. I actually have two videos of this today. And you can tell when he's doing the call because it kind of poofs out there. There, you could just barely hear it. So I think the first thing he does, and I don't think they do this all the time, is they yawn. Let's see that again. He actually yawns here. Yep. And then he goes right into... there we go. I think that's a... we'll just get the yawn in there. We'll call that an endpoint for a favorite. Wait till he's done calling. Call that an out point, and we'll mark that as a favorite here today. And up here, we moving the camera, trying to find the bird, trying to find the focus for the bird. Yeah, I know this can get you seasick watching this footage. And sometimes you got to go through a lot of footage to get to the little segment that you can use. All right, so we'll, right before the big shake there, call that a favorite. Now, one of the other things we're going to do today, as we go out and shoot, we accumulate a lot of video on many different subjects, and finding that video in the future is always difficult from the hundreds of video clips that we have. So one of the ways with Final Cut Pro X that we can simplify this is to turn on keywording for the clip. So we can actually add a keyword, and some simple keywords for some basic categories gets you a long way in eliminating the dragonflies from the birds, you might say. So one of the things we can do here is pull up the keywords and just pick my pre-assigned keywords here. And in the future, we'll be able to much more easily find this. And when you add a keyword, you can see that the little blue line appeared there. And we can do the same thing with this little clip here. We can go up here and grab the keyword list, hit our birds, and now that's going to be sorted and much easier to find. Now, the eastern tent caterpillar, and they're a moth, and they're part of the Lappet moths family. And I knew the nest was there on the entrance to the trail that I take at the park. And the nest is pretty well empty. Usually there's a lot of little caterpillars in the nest. Just this one little guy left, and he's looking like he's looking for somebody. And he must be confused too as to the direction he should go, because he's just kind of looking around. Maybe we'll go back where we started from. No, let's go this way. And if at first you don't succeed, head toward the leaves, I guess, is the motto here. So that was an interesting little clip there of just him going around circles. So we'll start the clip off about here as an endpoint. And we'll make that an out. We'll make this a favorite. And we'll give that a keyword. And let's just give it a keyword of... There we go, moths. We should be able to find that in the future a little easier now. Now, these little tent caterpillars are kind of a social group. Most caterpillars you see in the wild are by themselves. And the tent caterpillars are a little bit different. They live in that webbed nest. They are in the nest until it's time in the morning to go out for a feeding, and they all leave. And they all feed on the leaves of their tree that they're located on, and then they all go back to the nest for a couple hours. And then later in the day, they come out of their nest and go and feed, and then they all go back to their nest. And I think they do that about three times a day. So here we can see them all munching down on the leaves. There's three of them there, and there's one on the bottom and the left a little bit, kind of in the background, looking for his leaf. These guys are just munching here. And, of course, the wind's blowing a little bit, making it difficult to get a steady shot here. And the wind really blows, and I lose it completely. And at the end here, the wind just keeps blowing. Now, there's a total of five little caterpillars there now. So let's take the... part where the wind isn't blowing so much and call that an in. And we'll right about there. And then it starts blowing a little bit. We'll make that a favorite. They're a beautiful little caterpillar, but a lot of people consider these as very destructive and would rather have them dead. I've noticed as I post some of these videos of these caterpillars in the past, you either love them or hate them, and the people that hate them really hate them. All right, and let's go right up to the keywords, and we'll We'll just start typing moths. The larva stage of a moth. Now, walking up through the trail at the edge of a field, a big bird left the tree right in front of me, and he left with a lot of commotion. There was a lot of commotion going on, and he landed in the top of this tree here, and I could tell that he was unwanted in the neighborhood. These guys, they come in and they eat squirrels and birds, anything they can get a hold of. And birds, smaller birds, try to drive them out of the territory sometimes to make it safer for everybody. And you can see there's a bird just flew through. I think it's a blue jay. And there's a blue jay that just popped up in the lower part of the screen. So there's a blue jay kind of trapped in the tree there with this big bad bird. And the other birds are taking swipes at this beautiful red-shouldered hawk here. So let's look at that again and see what just transpired there. So the hawk flew into the tree probably with the knowledge that there was potentially something to eat in this tree. And there you can see just right there a blue jay kind of pops his head up and is quite aware that the hawk is right above his head. Just taking this one frame at a time, 60 frames per second here. And there we can see the blue jay just pop up, and he's kind of keeping an eye on what's right above him. And oh my. So we play this one in slow motion. So the blue jay that was in the tree takes off, and another blue jay is going to take a swipe at the red-shouldered hawk here. You can see the beautiful blue jay. The hawk is kind of looking the other way, like I just missed that bird that was in the tree. This blue jay just takes a swipe. I don't know if he actually touched the hawk or not, or was just trying to distract the hawk so the other blue jay could get away, but that was an interesting little piece of footage there. Audio at 60 frames per second sort of sounds like a helicopter. So when you hear that helicopter sound, that means that I'm going through and I'm going through one frame at a time. There's another blue jay, a little bit further away than that first one was, kind of keeping the hawk, knowing that he's unwanted. And then the hawk, I believe, decides just to fly away and maybe find a better hunting ground here. There you can see the blue jays are just continually harassing the hawk. Hawk has his eye on another blue jay, I think, flying around. So he decides to take off here. Now, the tail on this hawk is what gives it away as a red-shouldered hawk. The red-shouldered hawk has a black and white tail, black and white stripes on his tail. And you can see the stripes pretty plainly there. And there you can see the beautiful coloration on the tail and the top of the wings there as he's flying away. Very, very big bird. Can easily grab hold of a squirrel, and if he has some flight room, if he has room to really flap his wings and he's not in the trees or the brush, he can take off with a squirrel in his talons and fly away. No match for small little unsuspecting birds. And beautiful bird. All right, let's find, I think this clip is just full of possibilities that we could narrow down. I think right there when the blue jay pops up out of the tree, and right to the end when the hawk takes off, we'll make that a favorite. And we'll go up here and give it a keyword there again. Now we have a red-bellied woodpecker here. Just flies right up into the tree. It's pretty far away, so I'm not really able to zoom in any more than this. Beautiful little woodpecker. Make that an out, and make that the in right at the beginning here. Call that our favorite. And we'll give it another keyword. Now, this is something totally different here now. This is not a bird or critter crawling around. This is what you call B-roll in the video production business. And it's not necessarily of action, but it's something that as you're talking about some action or you're doing some commentary, you can use in the background video here. And this is of a cedar-apple rust. It's a fungus kind of thing. And it is pretty complicated, the life cycle here. But very, very interesting, because you may have seen the results of this cedar-apple rust and always kind of wondered what was going on and what it was called. This is just the one form of it here, which we'll do an in and out here. And we'll go up and quick keyword this as a fungi. And let's look at the next video here. The rust interacts with the tree, and between the two of them they grow this almost golf size ball, a brown little ball. And I believe it's on an eastern cedar tree here in this case. And the proximity to apple trees is sort of required. As I said, it's interesting, and you may want to look up cedar apple rust to see what it's all about. Now, these balls have those little orange tentacles in them, and this set of tentacles is kind of dried up looking. And this is one of the stages of this fungus where these orange tentacles grow out. We'll see some, I can see some coming up here. This is a little further along stage, I believe, where the fungus's spores are on these tentacles and blow around to the other host trees, the apple trees, and infect the apple trees with this fungus. And I believe this is a little further stage here, and we can see what looks like these tentacles drying up. And just very interesting. I've been following this for a couple years. You can see some of the on the branch there in the back, some of the orange rust, and I believe they're all kind of connected here. So let's just take a little segment of this and we'll make that a favorite. Now, here's the same thing going on here, and here's one of these little cedar apple rust balls, and they can be almost as big as a golf ball. and in ways they sort of look like a golf ball at times. This is after a recent rain. When the rains come in the spring is when these tentacles really grow out of this ball. And it's just an interesting phenomenon that I'm going to put on to the website here, Nature's Wild Things. I just fascinated by things like this that are completely different than anything else you may see out there in nature, and you just kind of wonder, what is this thing in this tree? And in this case, it's a fungus. So I'm going to just pick a little segment of this here too, and as we said, this will be B-roll in a lot of cases here. We'll go up and put a keyword in there so we can find it, and we'll put our keyword in here so we can find it again. Just an interesting little fungus here. Now, we're also going to look at some lichens. I know they don't do anything. They don't jump. They don't sing. They just kind of sit there. But again, we are putting all manner of life onto the Nature's Wild Things website. And this can be some footage that we use to show off the lichens here. I am really not an expert in any of this stuff, but I really enjoy looking at the lichens here close up. Look at the relationship between the fungus and the lichens here. I think it's an interesting topic of study that I'm going to include in the website here. And again, we'll go up and we'll classify this as a fungus here. I think we're fungus and lichens. I think we're looking at both here in the photo. And then in this video, again, we're looking at a little bit of both here in the video. Let's put it in and out. Call that a favorite. We'll go up here and keyword this. And a third little close up. And call it a favorite. Now, one of the most common things somebody has in their herb garden, but it grows wild and profusely all over the countryside of North Carolina around us, is this chives. And this is my B-roll of it. So let's take a little bit of this. And in this case, let's just call it a plant. And we'll be able to find her easier. Now, on the trail in the woods a little bit, I came across a pine tree that was lit nicely in places. The light was filtering through onto the pine tree, and I observed these little birds flying around the pine tree intermittently. They weren't staying in one place long at all, but they were flying around, and there was a comfortable spot where I could set up the camera and the tripod and stand and try to get some video of these birds to identify what kind of birds they are or were, and to identify what they're doing a little bit. A lot of flying into the trees and sometimes not even landing and picking at the pine needles, and sometimes landing on the pine needles and trying to pick at the trunk of the tree. I don't know if they're after sap or just what they were trying to do. But this experiment in videography produce some close-up moments. I mean just seconds where you could see the bird and figure out what kind of bird you had. And the rest of the time it was this. And if I tried to go through all this footage, I mean it would just make you seasick. So we're not even going to try to go through all the footage. We're going to kind of skip over, and rest assured that I found a good 3 or 4 seconds worth of video in a 5-minute test of my ability to find these birds, focus on them, and try to take some video of them. And as you can see, I've got some footage, but most of it's just looking around in a tree. So we may be able to get a couple 3-second clips of videos of these birds, but I'm not sure any of this footage is going to make the website at all. Now, we kind of did our big loop at the park, and it's a wooded section of the park, and we came back out, and our little eastern tent caterpillar group had gotten together. As I said, it was a cool morning, so they kind of bundled up in a bundle here, and they proceeded to do what they do, and that's spend the next couple hours now at the nest. I'm assuming they do this pile on the nest to keep warm. I'm just not sure how this all works. I think it was maybe 39 degrees out this morning, and so it was pretty cool. And I think if I went back in an hour, I'd probably find these guys doing the same thing. But if I go back in a couple hours, they might be off all eating leaves again. So just an interesting little moth, and I'm interested in following the progression from a very small little caterpillar to a larger and larger caterpillar. And so we'll be seeing more of these caterpillars as time goes on. So I have some interesting footage there. The wind's blowing, so I won't be able to use the audio, but we'll make that an out, call that a favorite. And again, it's moths. Now, the next thing we're going to look at here is a red-winged blackbird. Now, from a distance, I've seen a lot of these red-winged blackbirds around, and they do have that little red spot right on their wing, their upper wing there. And I didn't realize how much of a white spot they had underneath it. In my case, the red-winged blackbirds were always 50 or 100 feet away, and any time I got even slightly close to them, they took off. So I never was able to really get a close-up. And this is not well lit here. He's more of a silhouette here. But you can see that he's singing. Now, the problem with the whole thing is I'm standing next to a country road with a lot of traffic on it, and there's cars going by. So we're going to hear a little bit of the singing, we're going to hear a little bit of the wind, and we're going to hear a little bit of cars going by. So let's see what we can hear here. Setting up the camera. Kind of looks like he uses his whole body to sing with. He's got to suck in air and billow it out. Maybe you hear one of the cars going by. So somewhere in this mix, I'll be able to take and create a little 30-second video of him singing, I believe. One of the goals with the Nature's Wild Things website is to be a mugshot book, you might say, of all the different birds and critters you may find in your travels here. And one of my personal goals is to try to find as many birds as I can singing. Videotaping singing adds a whole dimension of audio that has to be clean and good enough to be able to hear the birds sing. And I live in a very urban air or sound polluted region. If there's not wind blowing, there's cars going by, there's airplanes going over, so I don't have the best ability to get really good clean songs from the birds, but what I do get, I'll try to use. So this entire clip here has some places where we may go through and take the quietest segments and turn it into a 30-second video here. And we'll take that clip and give it a bird's keyword here. And now we're back to this very interesting Cedar-Apple Rust. And we'll go give this whole clip here a fungi rating keyword. And now you guys are going to think I'm nuts, but this is a plant. And we always take photos and videos of plants and their beautiful flowers, but there's always a stage in the life of the plant when the flowers aren't there. And I enjoy the ability to take photos and videos of plants as they're just starting up in the spring, as they're pushing their first buds out, their first flowers out, and over time being able to track what the life cycle is of these plants. So a single photo and a single video clip of a plant tells you just a snippet of the life of that life cycle of that plant. And my hope with Nature's Wild Things is over time, over many photo walks, we can start adding to the photo albums and adding to the video repertoire of the plants. And then as you look at these plants, you can see them in more of their life cycle rather than just a brief snippet of a flower that doesn't tell any of the backstory of what that plant looked like as it was starting to grow and what the leaf structure is like and what the buds look like before the flower comes out. So that's our goal at Nature's Wild Things, is to tell the story of life here. So let's take this and we'll give this an in and an out, and we'll go up here and we'll call this one a plant here. And I believe we have another segment of Nature Discovery Screencast in the can.
Mm-hmm.